Hey, everybody. Welcome. The predecessor for the game that I'm about to review and share with you today was one of the most brilliant solitaire designs I've ever played. It is firmly entrenched in my hall of awesomeness for all time. So it was with no small excitement and anticipation that this landed in my hands. It is Fleet Commander Nimitz, the latest in the Commander series, designed by Dan Verssen and published by DVG Games. You are put in the position of the Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Pacific Fleet right after the attack on Pearl Harbor. Pretty stressful situation to be in. So, a lot I want to say, a lot I want to show you. So let's get to the table and check out Fleet Commander Nimitz.
Let's have a quick look at the components. Got a nice, big, beautiful, wrapped, fully mounted map here of the entire Pacific Theater. There are boxes for reinforcements, Japanese reinforcement rolls, American reinforcements. Here's your Japanese orders table. Sequence of plays printed on the map. It really does a good job of keeping the footprint, I think, to a minimum for a campaign of this scale, but still doing a great job of just conveying the vastness of the Pacific Theater. You get a single D10 with the game. Here are your setup sheets for the four campaigns included with the game, 1942 through 45. They will list the types of units and locations that must be set up and randomized prior to every game play, and your victory objectives and scoring chart. Counters. I love these counters. They are clear, they are colorful, they are easy to read. All the information you need for each unit is clearly printed on the counters. Nice, big, thick. Love these counters. They stack like poker chips. And for storage, you have a separate set of counters, both Japanese and American, for each of the four campaigns. Snack-sized Ziplocs work great. Then whatever campaign you want to play, just grab the appropriate year, open them up, and set them up. You've got a campaign log sheet for extended campaigns. Watch my commentary before you run off copies of this. Here is our battle board, our battle mat. This is where you will be setting up American and Japanese forces for the actual combat in this game. If you pre-ordered, you got a mounted version of this. For the purposes of this overview, though, I'm just going to show you the standard version. It's a cardstock. It's very nice. It's thick. It's glossy. And finally, we have the rulebook. It is a standard DVG rulebook, more narrative in style, a lot of good pictures. Examples are included with many of the rules. I have some rather pointed comments, though, about this rulebook that I will be sharing with you later. But yeah, it's pretty standard fare for DVG. More narrative style, great for reading and getting the gist of the game. Not so great when it comes to using it as an in-game reference. And the general counters that are used for all the different scenarios will easily fit into a single counter tray. Here is our box for Fleet Commander Nimitz. It is big. It is deep. What we got here? 4 inches deep. Plenty of room for all of your components, plus additional counter trays. Anything you want to, any little extra goodies you want to throw in with your game. Good sturdy box. So there's your components. The premise of the game is that you are put into the shoes of Fleet Commander Chester Nimitz during World War II. It's the war in the Pacific, grand strategic. The Japanese, depending on the scenario that you select, will generally be occupying territories in the western part of the map. And the Japanese will generally be trying to push east towards Hawaii and occasionally south into towards Australia and down into these southern territories. Over the course of the game, you'll be getting reinforcements, so will the Japanese. All combat is resolved. Any combat that takes place in the campaign map is moved to the battle mat, and conflicts are resolved here. At the end of each turn and at the end of each scenario, you must hold a certain number of objectives that are designated on the campaign setup sheet. You're given a rating based on the number of objectives you hold. For example, here, the 1943 campaign, 4 or fewer at the end of any turn or at the end of the game, and you lose. Objectives are marked with these markers here. If they are held by the U.S., they are on their blue side. If they are being contested or if they are held by the Japanese, they are flipped to the red side. One little thing, any Japanese force that makes it to the Hawaiian Islands and remains there after one battle turn, that is an automatic loss. Let's have a look at the gameplay. So, you begin the game by choosing your selected campaign year and then setting up all the Japanese and American forces on the campaign map, according to how it is listed on your setup sheet. Japanese forces must all be randomized with your naval, air, and land units randomized separately for each location. Once your game is set up, you simply follow the sequence of play, which is printed directly on your campaign map, starting by advancing the turn counter. And the game begins with the campaign turn counter on the start space. As you can see, each campaign turn reflects 2 months of the campaign year you've selected for your game. There is a resupply step where the U.S. will gain reinforcement and supply points, which are printed here on the setup sheet, each campaign turn for the resupply step. And those points can be used to repair units that may have been damaged in a previous turn, but also to purchase units from the U.S. reinforcement boxes. Now, your reinforcement points may only be used to purchase new units from the reinforcement boxes. You may also augment your reinforcement points with regular supply points. And units are purchased for their point value, which will be printed in brackets directly on the unit's counter. So you can spend your full... You can spend your 14 reinforcement points purchasing units to augment your forces for the coming turn. You place your purchased units, you spend your reinforcement points, Anything you buy above and beyond your reinforcement points, you can augment with your supply points. Now, be careful with these supply points. You're going to be pinching these supply counters until they squeal over the course of this game. Next up is a scouting phase where you can get a sneak peek at what certain Japanese units will be doing ahead of time. Each scouting roll will cost you one supply point. So if I want to know what this Japanese force in the Marshall Islands is about to do, I'll just place one of my scouting markers there. And then rolling 1d10, I'll take a roll on the Japanese order chart. They can be ordered to hold, they can be ordered to send a certain number of each type of unit back to Japan for refit, head south closer to Australia, head east closer to Hawaii, join a battle that's already in progress, engage closest U.S. forces. They can reinforce an objective with Japanese forces ashore, or they can sortie closest objective with U.S. present. And there's a breakdown: how many are the maximum number of ships, infantry, and land-based aircraft. So let's say we rolled a 5 and received an east order for those Marshall Islands forces. We would then take that scouted force and move them one closer to Hawaii and flip the counter to the in-transit side. Then there is a movement phase beginning with U.S. movement first. By the way, you can scout up to 4 times if you want to spend the supply points to do it. Movement starts with the United States, then the Japanese. Now, you can move American forces, no matter where they are, anywhere on the map. The hitch is, for each force you move, you have to spend a supply point. So let's say the Japanese looks like they're reinforcing there at Wake Island. So I'll take this aircraft carrier. I got here a couple of cruisers, a couple more cruisers from the West Coast, and a couple of infantry. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 units, and I'll move them to Wake Island. That's going to cost me 7 supply points. And continue with this until you've moved all the forces on the map that you want. One thing to take note of, like here in the Gilberts, the last land-based force, whether American or Japanese, whether infantry or land-based aircraft, can never be moved out of an area. The Japanese movement step then begins, and it can be rather lengthy. Any area where the Japanese force is ineligible to receive any kind of movement orders, pretty much where there is only one land-based force, you're going to place moved counters to remind you that you won't be moving those units. And then what you do, any scouted units, by the way, you also remove that in-transit counter and place a moved counter on them as well. And then what you do is you go area to area. And anywhere there is an area that has Japanese units eligible to take movement orders, you will roll for orders. So, like, for example, if we were starting up here with this large force in Japan, we would begin rolling for orders on the Japanese orders chart. So Let's say we rolled an east order. That's 4 ships, 2 infantry, and 2 land-based aircraft, one closer to Hawaii that has Japanese forces ashore. So then we would take our, what, four ships, two infantry, and two aircraft, and move them one area closer to Hawaii. You would then continue rolling for all forces in Japan, eligible to receive orders until those are all resolved for their movement, and then move on to the next area. And you go one area at a time, making sure that you roll for orders for every Japanese force eligible to receive one. Oh, and one quick thing, Japan and East Asia, you can remove the last land-based force from those two areas. That's an exception. Once all of the Japanese movement is complete, you're going to move on to the resolved battles phase. And what that means is anywhere on the map where you have both Japanese and American forces occupying the same area, a battle is going to take place. We'll just use Wake Island as our little example. All the forces in the selected battle that you've chosen to play out, you'll place on the combat mat, assigning carrier-based aircraft to each aircraft carrier that you have participating in the battle. And follow the setup sequence for the battle, starting with you moving U.S. forces to the battle map, move Japanese forces to the battle map. There are instructions in the rules for specific placement of Japanese forces. You're going to roll 1d10 and randomly determine how many turns there will be for this specific battle. Some battles will be very long, going a full 5 battle turns. Some will be short, being one turn only. Then you're going to determine the number of battle plans that the Japanese get according to how many forces they have on involved in the current battle. So we'll discuss battle plans more in just a moment. Then there is a stage where you will purchase American battle plans. You are given a default of 3 battle plan points, which you can spend on battle plans at the beginning of each battle. You can spend one of your precious supply points for 3 extra battle plan points to spend on more battle plans. And what they do is they just give your forces an advantage in a specific area for each battle. American battle plans are used once and discarded, whereas Japanese battle plans will generally be persistent for the length of the battle turn. You'll then draw the required number of Japanese battle plans randomly from a draw cup. And like the American battle plans, they will confer little advantages for the Japanese force. But in the case of the Japanese battle plans, they will apply to their whole force for the length of the battle turn. You then move U.S. aircraft to any area on the map you wish. Either Japanese ocean, the coastal area, the island area, and then after you've moved all U.S. aircraft, then you will roll separately for first Japanese bombers, then Japanese fighters. You will roll, and the values are listed right here on the combat mat. If you're rolling for example, the bomber group from this Japanese carrier, roll of 1 or 2 puts them in the Japanese ocean region. Roll of 3 to 5 has them going to the island region. A roll of 6 has them going to the coastal region, and 7 to 10 will have them attacking the U.S. ships in the U.S. ocean region. Then you do similar die rolls for all Japanese fighter aircraft. And then you'll be able to finally start mixing it up with actual combat. The combat is resolved in steps for all the different units. First, dog fighting. Any aircraft that occupy the same area will be able to have fighter combat. Fighters must roll their printed attack number or less. If they roll that, they inflict one hit. If they roll their superscript number or less, they will inflict two hits. After the dogfighting, there's a round of AAA fire from the naval vessels. These naval vessels' printed numbers are anti-aircraft, naval gunfire, and then anti-submarine depth charging. So all the ships will be able to fire at any aircraft in their area. Then the bombers will be able to drop their bombs on any targets that are in their area. The number bordered in blue is their attack number against naval vessels. The brown bordered number is their attack number against land targets. And again, they have to roll their attack number or less. There's a round of torpedo fire for any submarines that may be on the combat mat. There's no anti-aircraft number for submarines. And that blue bordered three means that their naval fire can only be used for naval vessels, period. They can't conduct naval fire against shore targets. And they have their own anti-submarine value. There's a naval gunfire phase. Ships that are in the coastal area will be able to fire at each other, and they may also fire at land-based targets, infantry, airfields, land-based aircraft, etc. Then there is an infantry combat phase. Any infantry that is ashore and occupying their foxholes may conduct combat. An infantry advance phase. Any infantry that is on transports or hit the beaches on a previous combat turn may now advance toward their foxhole positions. And that resolves the combat. Then you inflict any airfield losses on your aircraft. That means, for example, this aircraft carrier, if it took a hit, it can no longer take any carrier-based aircraft aboard, so any returning carrier-based aircraft would be destroyed. Land-based aircraft, if this airfield had taken a hit and received damage, this Japanese land-based aircraft would no longer be able to land. It would be destroyed and removed from the game. And then finally, you advance the battle turn counter and proceed through the combat phases again, discarding Japanese battle orders and drawing new ones. Combat continues until the battle turn marker runs out, or until one side of the other or the other has been wiped off the combat map. Then there's a reinforcement phase for the Japanese, where you will roll 1d10 and determine a random number of ships, infantry, and land-based aircraft to move out of the reinforcement box and into Japan. The die roll can be modified depending on whether or not you have submarines in the raiding box to penalize the Japanese, or resupply markers that the Japanese may have earned during their orders step. There's a Japanese repair phase where any damaged Japanese units are flipped to their full strength side and placed at the bottom of their respective reinforcement pile for possible deployment on a future turn. Then there's the U.S. return to port phase. This is meant to simulate ships having to return to port to be repaired, replenished, upgraded, etc. And the way that works is any ships that are currently deployed to the campaign map and are not in Hawaii or the American West Coast are removed from the campaign map. Units already in the return to port boxes are moved up. These just got deployed to Hawaii, so they're ready for the next turn. And then the ships that you already have on the campaign map are placed in the return to port box appropriate for the year of the campaign you're playing. As you can see, depending on the year of the campaign you're playing, ships can be out of action for up to 3 campaign turns. You must then do a supply check. Each of the areas where you have troops not engaged in combat, you need to be able to trace a route, an uninterrupted route of American occupied areas to whichever area you're checking. Any area that you cannot is out of supply. And then those units must be flipped to their reduced side. And at the end of the campaign turn, do a defeat check by counting up your objectives that you currently are in possession of and compare them to the chart on your campaign setup sheet. If you have a poor rating at the end of any campaign turn or at the end of the game itself, if you have a replaced rating, then you lose the game. Play continues going through complete campaign turns, moving the campaign turn marker down towards the end after every turn, doing defeat checks, checking objectives to determine loss or victory.
Okay. Before I launch, I just want to say, I mean, you already heard my opinion at the beginning of the video of this game's predecessor, Field Commander Napoleon. I was wild about it. It was and still is one of my all-time favorite solitaire war games. That said, I'm also consciously aware, regardless of what my expectations were going in, that each game is its own unique beast. Even games in the same series or system should be played and evaluated based solely on its own merits. They are their own unique creation and should be evaluated on their own merits without making constant comparisons. So going forward, you know what's important to you, and you can decide if the comments I'm about to make are fair or not. But I gotta be honest, I don't want to sell the game short, okay? There is fun to be had in this box, some really good gameplay. I did enjoy playing it, but I had some real issues with Fleet Commander Nimitz, starting with the rulebook. It is a pretty standard DVG rulebook in that it's the more narrative style. It's got a lot of pictures and examples. And that this type of rulebook has always been a bit problematic for me personally. Some are better than others. This is not one of DVG's better rulebooks, I'm sorry to say. There are several places where the rules are very, very clear, and the example does a very good job of explaining how to implement that rule. And then in a lot of places, The rules are very vague, very ambiguous, and the provided example left me kind of scratching my head. There are just parts of this rule book that I'm sorry to say have a real rough draft feel to them. I don't know how else to put that. So I had some problems with this rule book. And then moving on to the game itself. Again, there's some good gameplay here. But there are some mechanical issues that I encountered with this game. Now, Fleet Commander Nimitz, as with all games in the Commander series from DVG, are meant to convey broad, just paint a big picture. There's a lot of abstraction that goes on. It's meant to give you the big picture strategic situation. And I'm a big fan of abstraction, where it aids in gameplay, where it assists the flow and pace of the game, where it eliminates needless complexity. So I was aware of that going in as well too. But again, mechanically, there's just some problems with this game, such as the way land-based aircraft are handled, as opposed to carrier-based aircraft. All aircraft in the game are vulnerable to many of the same things. Enemy fighters, anti-aircraft fire. But land-based aircraft, in addition to that, are vulnerable because they're airfields. It's the way that hits are allocated. Damage is allocated to units according to their unit value, with the lower valued units being first to absorb damage before higher valued units. And with island combat, damage cannot be assigned to enemy infantry, even if they're of lower value, unless you already have infantry of your own on the island. No naval gunfire can be assigned to them, no bombing can be assigned to them. So ultimately what you have is a situation where the land-based airfields get wiped out very quickly. And land-based aircraft are not cheap when you're purchasing them with supply points. And the effect that that had on my gameplay was, when I was purchasing reinforcements, I didn't even want to buy land-based aircraft unless they were the last units in that reinforcement pile, simply because they are just so very vulnerable. It just made for some really funky situations during the combat phases of my games. In addition, land-based aircraft, well, they're destroyed once the airfield is destroyed, whether they've taken damage or not. And land-based aircraft are removed from the game for good, as opposed to carrier-based aircraft, particularly in the case of the Japanese. If the carrier survives the battle, the aircraft that are carrier-based are magically resurrected in the next campaign turn. Now, either one of these things in and of themselves would be fine, but when put together in the same game, in the same combat, it just really made a big disconnect for me. Also, the system of Japanese orders didn't provide for too many surprises for me. The Japanese will always tend to head east toward Hawaii, with some forces moving south, but almost all the action in the game is going to take place in the Midway Wake Island area, and it felt pretty repetitive after a while. There's a mechanical issue with being able to hold an entire massive Japanese task force stuck in one location, unable to advance with a single American unit. Again, it just made for a real thematic disconnect for me. It really made for some funky combat situations that really served to kind of take me out of the theme, take me out of the game. It just didn't feel right. So to sum it up, just really not very good rule book, combined with some really just clunky mechanical issues, combined to, I'm sorry to say, leave me feeling disappointed. Fleet Commander Nimitz does achieve some of what I think it sets out to do. Because the battles have some mechanical issues is not to say that they weren't occasionally enjoyable. You really do get that sense of, you know, carrier-based aircraft reaching out to the enemy fleet to target those all-important enemy carriers. When you get comfortable with the steps of combat, it can be quite hectic and enjoyable. I don't want to say this game isn't enjoyable at all, because it is. Finally, the cherry on the cake for me, though, it's the war in the Pacific. It's grand strategic. Anyone who gets this game is going to want to play out that war from beginning to end. There is no provision for that in this game. You have the four campaigns played separately, that's it. The rules for linked campaigns in this game are play four separate campaigns completely independent of one another, the preceding game having no effect on the next. So all those Japanese carriers you worked so hard to sink in 1942, many of them will be magically resurrected in 1943. Territory that you fought hard to gain or lost at great cost in the previous campaign will be magically given back to you or taken away in the next. Play those four games separate from one another and then combine your scores. That's the rule for linked campaigns. I'm mystified by that. It feels like you just got to that part of the rule book and decided you didn't feel like working on it anymore. I don't know. I'm mystified by that. What can I say? Very disappointing. It just didn't measure up for me. For a game at this price point, I believe it's $89.99 on the publisher's website. For a game in this lineage, for a game with this kind of potential, in the end, I even though I enjoyed myself, I ended up kind of disappointed. So I think this game would probably be suitable for the more casual wargamer that doesn't mind an extensive setup time. You do have to place all of those named units in a specific location for each scenario. In addition, Japanese stacks must be kept constantly randomized throughout the game. So the casual player that doesn't mind an extended setup time may enjoy this game. But for the more experienced wargamer, I'm sorry to say, I think Fleet Commander Nimitz may be an abstraction too far. I don't think it's going to provide the experience you're looking for. That's going to do it. A fun game with several letdowns along the way. So that's going to do it for Fleet Commander Nimitz, designed by Dan Verssen and published by DVG. If you'd like to see more of my game reviews and turn walkthroughs, I hope you'll head over to my YouTube channel and hit that subscribe button. If you'd like a more in-depth, detailed look at the turn mechanics for this game, please see my separate Nuts and Bolts video. That's going to be it for now. Thank you for joining me, everybody. And until next time, happy gaming.